It's a real pleasure for me to come back to UCL. As Jason said, I started my professional career here. I was a lecturer in the geography department just across the road, focusing mainly on migration and refugees. That seems quite distant from my current position, and of all of the things you read out, the paid position is as the executive director of this rather wordy Global Community Engagement and Resilience Fund, which is a global fund focusing on preventing violent extremism, and I'll spend this presentation talking about what we're trying to do. But I would like to make this point. I'm speaking to young, brilliant academics with a bright future ahead of you. I strongly believe that what I learnt at UCL and what I learnt as an academic before I left academia has given me the skills that I require to do this job, even though it seems very different and distant from academia. And three ways in particular that I look at my academic career, which was about 10 years before I moved on, as an important formative occasion, formative time for giving me the skills that I'm doing now. One is universities taught me about a commitment to social change. I think that's what universities are for, and I think that's what universities are about, and I think that's what people like Ben and Jason are trying to do with you. It's a commitment to social change, and that's a commitment that I've carried from my university career through my current, my various positions and through to my current role. A second thing that I think my university career taught me was a real belief in the potential of young people. And I hope that my colleagues at GCERF, the Global Community and Engagement and Resilience Fund, would tell you that I am a boss, an executive director, who tries my best to inspire young people and to help young people expand and improve and go forward. And I think that's what academics are supposed to do. I think lots of people out in the professional world don't do it enough, and I think it's something, again, I've carried forward from my academic career. I think the third thing that I have learned or taken forward from my academic career is understanding the distinction between analysis and advocacy. And I'm just going to leave that there for the moment, but I might come back to that in a different context, and perhaps we can discuss that during the Q&A. Another couple of introductory comments. I'd just like to say a couple of words about why I took on this new challenge. And as I speak through these slides, I think you're going to see this is a particularly challenging role that I've taken on running this global fund, focusing on this rather difficult concept of preventing violent extremism. I took this job on for three main reasons. Firstly, it was a new intellectual challenge. I've spent the last 20 years working in various contexts on basically migration and refugees. And I relished the idea of learning about a completely different field, violent extremism, and how hopefully to counter or combat or prevent violent extremism. So I relished the intellectual challenge of doing something quite different in my career. I deeply regret that my past is beginning to collide with my present. There is, I think, a very unsavoury and very ill-informed discussion at the moment about the intersections between migration, refugees, asylum seekers, and the potential for violent extremism and terrorism. Look no further than Washington, D.C. I think this is grossly overplayed. I think there are some linkages we need to discuss, but I think we're making some very grave policy errors at the moment. And again, happy to come back and discuss some of the linkages between migration and the potential for violent extremism. I think we need to get that debate right. A second reason that I took on this challenge was that it was a startup. I always tell the story that about 2.5 years ago, I walked into literally an empty office with no coffee machine, no toilet roll, no staff, no statutes, no bylaws, nothing at all. And I'm modestly proud that 2.5 years later, we have a team of 25, we have diplomatic status, we're a Swiss foundation, we've raised around $40 million from 14 donors. We're working in 6 countries. We're reaching about 500,000 beneficiaries. And we've got a coffee machine and toilet roll as well. So we've done all that. we've done all of that in 2.5 years. And I think it's been quite a journey. And I would just like to introduce my colleague, Amy Cunningham, who's been with me almost since the beginning. And she takes as much credit as I do for getting us as far as we have. Any difficult questions at the end of this presentation, go to Amy. If you think GCERF's great, I will take all of the credit. That's how we work. That's called team. That's called leadership, ladies and gentlemen. That's called leadership. The third reason I took on the GCERF role was that it was a quite new and novel form of institution. And I know that many of you here are, of course, interested in global governance. I've worked in universities, think tanks, I've worked for the UN, I've worked for the civil service here in the UK. But the idea of working for a global fund, a funding mechanism, was something quite new. And I relished the idea of working in a different institutional environment or institutional setup. And that's what we're really here to discuss today for the next 25 minutes or so, is this multi-sectoral global fund, the concept, the idea, how GCERF is fitting into those premises, and what, as the title says, are the promises and the pitfalls. So those were a few introductory comments. What I thought I'd do is to structure my presentation briefly around three main themes. Firstly, a couple of slides on what multisectoral global funds are. They're still quite an unusual institutional creation. It's taken me 2 years to really understand what they are, and I think I'm just about getting there. So you shouldn't be surprised if you don't get it straight away, because it's taken me a long time to get it, and I supposedly run at one of them. So a few words about multisectoral global funds, and a few words about what the very thin literature, the academic literature, says are the strengths and weaknesses, the potentials and pitfalls of these sorts of institutions. So a few opening words about multisectoral global funds. For the second part of the presentation, I'd like to introduce GCERF, the Global Community Engagement and Resilience Fund. Again, a mouthful, but I'll use GCERF from now on. A bit about why GCERF was established, a bit about what I think we have achieved, and a bit about what I think we're hoping to achieve over the coming years. And then for the final part of the presentation, again, I'll keep it brief, I want to use the GCERF example to illustrate the successes and failures, the promises and pitfalls of multisectoral global funds. So to reflect back on that academic literature and tell you about my experiences of running a multisectoral global fund over the last 2.5 years, and what's worked and what hasn't worked, and what the advantages and disadvantages are. Let me make one final introductory point. There are some mega funds out there. The Global Fund on HIV, AIDS, TB and malaria has a budget of about $16 billion. Right? There's Gavi, the Vaccine Alliance, that has a budget of $4 billion. We have a far more modest fund at the moment, but I would argue that gives us more insight into what the challenges are. Sometimes it's a small dinghy on the ocean that gets to read the waves and the winds perhaps a bit more than the huge liners pressing towards New York. So I think we've got a particular insight into what works and doesn't work around these concepts of multisectoral global funds. So quickly, that's the structure I'd like to follow. Okay, what is a multisectoral global fund, an MGF for short? Well, this is the definition that you will find used by the UN, by most governments, by DFID, by various other donors, and so on and so forth. A multisectoral global fund is a financial instrument whose primary purpose is to attract, manage, and disperse resources for global purposes. I reflect, and I'm on camera and I'll still reflect, that I can scarcely manage my own bank account, and here I am trying to run a financial instrument. So let's see how far we get with that. The attract, manage and disperse, I think, is really important. As I said, I think we've done quite well in raising funds. We, of course, have to manage those funds. These are taxpayers' money, and we have to make sure that we are absolutely transparent and responsible with that. And spending the money, actually, I found to be the most difficult part of that trilogy. Attracting money has been relatively straightforward. Managing the money, we have a fantastic chief financial officer who does a great job on that. Spending the money in the right way, trying to make a difference, trying to have an impact, I think that's the real challenge at the moment. So ironically, it's the spending, not the attracting, that I found particularly difficult, and I'll come back to that later in this presentation. Three defining characteristics of any multi-sectoral global fund, MGF. First, they are issue-based. These funds focus on single issues, be it health or climate change, or in our case, violent extremism. Secondly, they are by definition multi-stakeholder. This awful, we had a discussion about whether or not to hyphenate it, whether you hyphenate it or not, it's an awful UN multi, I mean, welcome to my world, multi-stake, I mean, all this kind of terrible language, but the point is it's not just governments. It's governments, it's foundations, it's private sector, it's civil society. The point of these things is to try to widen the audience, widen the scope, widen the governance of these issues. So it's very much deliberately extending beyond governments and the UN alone. And the third defining characteristic is that these are independent. The UN is owned by its member states. International organizations are owned by the member states. Bilateral donors are owned by the government for which they work. Multisectoral global funds are independent. And as I've said, we are a Swiss foundation based in Geneva. You can't get too much more independent than that. So that's what an MGF, a multisectoral global fund, is. The literature on MGFs is surprisingly thin. Surprisingly thin given the billions of pounds that are being spent and dispersed via MGFs. There's really not much literature at all on them. And anyone who's looking for a PhD on global governance, I think a really good study of MGFs, of what works, of what doesn't work. There's only about 15 in the world, so it'd be fairly easy to actually do the research and speak to all of the executive directors. But not much literature at all, surprisingly, on multisectoral global funds. The literature that does exist, I think, identifies these strengths and weaknesses. And at the end of the presentation, I'll come back to this list and tell you how GCERF is trying to leverage the strengths and address some of these weaknesses. Some of the strengths, at least theoretically, of multisectoral global funds, why we set up these new, quite unusual institutions to finance development funding towards various issues. One is they provide a political focal point on difficult issues. You will be aware, of course, that the Dutch government has just announced they're going to set up a new multisectoral global fund on, effectively, abortion, in response to what Mr. Trump has done in terms of not funding international organisations that are supporting family planning and abortion. So it's one way to get political attraction, political traction around difficult political issues that perhaps are beyond the UN, that perhaps are beyond any single country, any single donor. And I've told you the list: climate change, AIDS, abortion now, violent extremism. These are all examples of issues that are difficult politically for any single entity and indeed any international organisation to cope with alone. So there's a strong notion of political momentum and political traction that is supposed to be channeled through these funds. Secondly, resource mobilisation. The point of these things, and again, remember, it's about attracting, managing, dispersing. My job is immensely, of all of the jobs I've had, this is the easiest because the mandate is so clear. My job is to raise money, to manage money, and to spend money, and that's it. It's actually quite refreshing. Unlike academics who've got to lecture and research and administer, my job is very straightforward. I have a very singular mandate. The fund is about resource mobilisation, and our job is to go out to as many different stakeholders, governments, private sector foundations, and raise money. And by setting up an institution that is dedicated to raising money, you can do what governments and what the UN and other international organisations can't do because they're trying to do so many other things at the same time. We are dedicated to raising money on a particular issue. That's the point of setting up a multisectoral global fund. It's about expanding reach. No single country, not even perhaps the UN in certain sectors, can get a global reach, particularly on difficult political issues. Setting up a multisectoral global fund should be a way to expand the reach of any bilateral donor and of most international organisations. And I'll come back to the question of reach and how GCERF, I think, is beginning to expand reach in a couple of minutes again. It spreads risk. These are issues that are politically sensitive: abortion, climate change, violent extremism, and probably too politically sensitive for any single country to take on by themselves. I can't imagine many countries taking the lead alone on any of those issues, but if you spread the risk, if you bring 20 countries around the table, then you can begin to spread the risk, then you can begin to get into a comfort zone where we're all in this together, we all rise or fall, succeed or fall together. These funds are intended to spread risk that no single country is willing to take on by itself. And finally, of course, there's a question of economies of scale and expertise. If you put large amounts of money into a single funding institution, it can achieve economies of scale. Gavi, the Vaccine Alliance, buys billions of dollars of vaccines at knockdown prices. No one else can do that. It uses its economic muscle to buy vaccines at knockdown prices. We are achieving economies of scale in a different way. I'll come back to that. But you certainly set these things up to try to achieve economies of scale and also expertise. Multisectoral global funds are about centralising expertise on particular issues that are way beyond what any single government or any single UN agency can achieve by themselves. It's a way of really focusing expertise in all sorts of areas in a single institution. Against that set of strengths, the literature points out, I think, some really important weaknesses too. One is, and it goes back to this point about being issue-based, you are making policy in isolation. You're focusing on one particular issue. We know in this transnational world, we know in this multi-connected world, that all issues are related. And I'm not working for Gavi or the Global Fund, but, you know, HIV is related to sex workers, it's related to cultural norms, and so on and so forth. If you only focus on the vaccines, you're not really getting the whole picture because there's so much else out there. All of this stuff is interconnected. One of the great criticisms of multisectoral global funds is they are trying to do this stuff in isolation. They haven't got a way to try to link up all the other parts of the jigsaw puzzle. That's what international organisations are good at, and that's what multisectoral funds are not good at. So you need to recognise that this is a small part of a bigger picture, again, focusing on funding and focusing on a single issue. Secondly, they are less democratically accountable than international organisations and, of course, than DFID and other development agencies around the world. I don't answer to taxpayers. I don't answer to voters. I answer to a robust board, a board that gives me hell, frankly, twice a year, but still it's a small board to which I have to report. Amy comes, we make various presentations, it's a two-day presentation, but we're not particularly democratically accountable to you, the taxpayers, and you are paying for my salary and paying for the work that we're doing. So there is this question of the accountability of multisectoral global funds. Somehow you're removing yourself from democratic accountability. I think that's a strong criticism that's worth making. The risk of duplication. Unless you get this right, what multisectoral global funds end up doing is more of the same. DFID's providing money on vaccines. The UN, WHO, UNAIDS, UNITAID are all doing work around AIDS, and so is the Global Fund. The last thing you want to do is set up a new institution that simply duplicates what other people are doing. And I think duplication is something you have to guard against. The risk that you become substitutive, not additive, that the work you are doing is simply substituting the work of bilateral donors and not adding value. And I think we've seen that across various funds and to an extent at GCERF too, and it's certainly something that we have to risk guard against going forward. And the final criticism you often see of multi-sectoral global funds is that you are diverting responsibility. What about national governments? What about the United Nations? The Global Fund on AIDS, TB and malaria, the big beast, the $16 billion beast, is often criticised for basically letting governments off the hook. They come in, they provide the money, and they take responsibility away from you and your governments. It's no longer your problem. The Global Fund will sort it out. So you've got to find a way to make sure that you are doing work, but also making sure that other people who should be responsible are responsible for that work, working in partnership with them and not somehow replacing them. And the final point here about dependency is immensely important. And again, it's one of the criticisms that has been levelled at the Global Fund, the big Global Fund, is that it risks generating dependency. If the Global Fund puts billions of dollars each year into AIDS, TB and malaria, into health systems in various poorer countries in the world, then why bother funding those systems? Why not just depend on the Global Fund? So you have to find a way to guard against dependency. Again, thin literature, but I think some of the main strengths and weaknesses that come out of the literature. Part one, MGFs and what the literature says are some of the strengths and weaknesses. Okay, part two briefly, a few words about GCERF. I'm a travelling salesman. As the executive director of this thing, I spend my life travelling the world, selling it. I'm not here to sell, I'm not here to pitch. We're academics, let's have a sensible discussion. But I want to tell you a few words about GCERF and then use GCERF to reflect back on this question of MGFs and why they work and whether they work and whether we should go forward with them and so on and so forth. This is GCERF. This is from our literature. GCERF is a unique global effort to support local, community-level initiatives aimed at strengthening resilience against violent extremist agendas. It's a bit of a mouthful. This was a fund that was set up by a steering committee. We're trying to keep lots of people happy, consensus, you know, creating a camel rather than a horse, you know all the phrases. But that, I think, paragraph roughly summarises what we are. We're a global fund. We're focusing on local communities, and we are trying to prevent violent extremism at the local level. And I'll come back to how we're doing that in a moment. These are the three premises upon which GCERF was founded about 2.5 years ago. The first was that, if not the only place, certainly one of the most important places to try to prevent violent extremism is at the local level. You have to focus on local communities. That's where the heat is, that's where the challenges are, that's where the solutions may be. Now, I think the international community broadly accepts this now. The UN issued a Preventing Violent Extremism Action Plan last year, and that was very much about local-level action. Lots of other people, organisations, recognise local-level action is important. I think GCERF was a bit of ahead of the game. I think when we were saying this 2.5 years ago and we were founded, not many people were yet on board. So, to an extent, we helped pioneer and helped to lead this agenda, but really, the belief that focusing at the local level is very important was one of the premises upon which GCERF was founded. A second premise was there's a significant funding gap. The solutions may be at the local level, but the money isn't. It may be that mothers and clerics and sports coaches frankly know much better than Chatham House and the Lowy Institute and Brookings Institution about what's going wrong and how to fix it, but they haven't got the money. And they haven't got the money because of politics. I'm a dual national UK, Pakistan, and I can tell you that half of Pakistan would never take money from the UK because they no longer trust the UK. There's and the same for the US, the same for France. We work with lots of donors who simply cannot access local communities because of that mistrust, because of colonialism, because of the horrors of the last 20 years of counterterrorism and so on and so forth. So there are political reasons why there's a funding gap. There's logistical reasons. Have you ever tried to fill in, I know colleagues in academia have you ever tried to fill in a research proposal or a log frame? Or the 30-page, and so on and so forth. Don't be surprised that 6 illiterate women in a village in Mali have absolutely no idea what they're doing. They have no notion, no capacity to do this. So there are capacity challenges as well. All sorts of reasons, and our research has been pretty solid on this, why we believe there's a funding gap at the local level. Great solutions, no money to launch them. The third premise, and I think the most controversial, was that the best way to fill the funding gap was through a multi-sectoral global fund. right? And that's why GCERF was established in the form that it was. And I'll come back to all of this in a few minutes. Just to illustrate that we are a multisectoral global fund, we are issue-based, we focus very clearly on violent extremism, and just to preempt the question, no, no one knows what violent extremism is, and there's no definition of it, but we can have that discussion afterwards, but we have a clear issue, which is violent extremism. We're multi-stakeholder, and let me just illustrate that in two ways. We have, and again, your students or experts on global governance, so this will mean more to you probably than me, but we have a multi-stakeholder constituency governing board, which means, and I haven't got the picture, there are 15 seats around the table, five for donors, five for beneficiaries, one for the private sector, one for foundations, one for civil society, and one for, who am I missing? Think tanks and policy, think and do tanks, as they call themselves these days. So 15 seats, multi-stakeholder, but behind each seat is a constituency. So I've already told you we have 14 donors, but they only have five seats. I'm going to tell you we have six beneficiaries, but they only have five seats. We have four people on the private sector constituency, but they only have one seat. And so the notion here is that this is supposed to be a manageable board, but widely constitutive. And the challenge for me, frankly, as executive director, is to do some of those negotiations. You know, you can imagine a donor comes in with a large amount of money and they have to join a constituency. And sometimes the person sitting at the table has given less money than that donor. And that donor, understandably, is a little bit irritated. And you have to really do the selling, that this is a model that has worked for other global funds. We think it works for GCERF, and I'm afraid you're just going to have to put up with it. There's kind of governance challenges around this. But, you know, I think really important that we are a multi-stakeholder outfit with a multi-stakeholder governing board. Very quickly, this CSM's acronym that I think is important. In each of the countries where we're working, we've set up local committees, country support mechanisms, CSMs. These bring together all of the relevant government ministries. They include civil society, they include the private sector, and they include representatives of our donors. And I would argue these are, as an aside, one of the reasons that the UN irritates me, and we live in Geneva, and so we're surrounded, one of the many reasons the UN irritates me is that I think the UN often mistakes process for outcome, right? We've met, we've had a dialogue, we've had a summit, and we've achieved something. No, you haven't. You've exchanged business cards, and you've built some confidence, and that's great, but what next, right? And that, I think the UN has lost that but what next piece. But sometimes it works, and I would argue these CSMs are an example of a process being an outcome. We have set up these local committees to help advisors on what funding to give and where to give it and which populations to support and so on and so forth. But what they've also done is provided, I think, a unique setting in some difficult countries to have a really focused discussion amongst various people around violent extremism. And I think that in itself is useful. And already in some countries like Bangladesh, these CSMs are now being used for purposes other than GCERF. So for example, UNDP is currently investing in Bangladesh, and our CSM is being used to evaluate the UNDP proposals. So we've set up something that I think can be of broader use to the international community and to the national level states than just GCERF. So this is a good example of process sometimes is a good outcome. But again, we are multi-stakeholder. And thirdly, clearly we're independent. We are a Swiss foundation, we are registered with the government in Bern, we're one of 26 organisations that has the status of an international organisation, we have diplomatic immunities, which is quite good to get in just 2.5 years, so we clearly have independence. So, a multi-sectoral global fund founded on these three main premises. Quickly, what are we doing? I'm going to show three pictures of the places we are currently supporting initiatives, which are Bangladesh, Mali, Nigeria. We're also launching this year in Kenya, Kosovo, and Myanmar, and I'll come back to that if you wish later. I'll use each of these slides to illustrate one point. This slide on Bangladesh, I'll just say something about the map. As you can see, we're working in Cox's Bazar, Satkhira, and Chalpai Nawambanj. Now, this is the point I'd like to make about the map, and you'll see this replicated for the Mali and Nigeria slides as well. The challenge of working on prevention is that you don't work in the areas that have already gone over the top. You're working in places where you think there's a flashing red light, where there seem to be warning signs, and where you think that intervening now might make a difference. That's prevention, and that's the challenge of prevention. It's like my old life of refugees. If you're trying to prevent refugee flows, frankly, I'd forget Syria, it's gone. I might start working in Kar or South Sudan or places where flows are beginning to emerge, but it might still be time to anchor them, to protect IDPs, all the other stuff that we might do around refugees. So we're often criticized for not working in the most difficult or dangerous of places. We're not working in northern Nigeria, we're working in the central belt. Our answer is, A, northern Nigeria is probably too difficult and dangerous for us to work in, and B, the warning signs are in the Central Belt. If you don't intervene now in the Central Belt, it risks becoming the new Northern Nigeria. So if your purpose is prevention, it leads you in interesting directions in terms of the populations and the regions and the drivers on which you're focusing. So let me just use this map to illustrate the challenges of focusing attention if you're really trying to achieve prevention. Second one I'll just use to illustrate the figures at the top. Very briefly, the way we disperse money, we work through local NGOs, which we call principal recipients. They establish consortia of community-based organisations, often unregistered, the sorts of people who never receive money, and that's the ultimate goal for GCERF. We have to get the money to them, and of course my job is to make sure that as much of the money that's committed as possible gets to those sub-recipients. And here in Mali, 3 PRs, 19 SRs, reaching, we think, 41,000 beneficiaries directly, but some of those beneficiaries would be media or teachers or clerics, which means that they are in turn influencing many other people. We think altogether we're reaching 500,000 people directly, but maybe 1.5 million people indirectly. Again, 2.5 years, it's not bad. Just as a quick note, the big global fund took 3 years before it paid a penny. The current climate change fund based in South Korea has been going for about the same time as us and hasn't yet issued a single grant. So I'm pleased that in a relatively short amount of time, we're at least on the ground and acting and beginning to try to make a difference. I think getting money out of the door is quite difficult for funds to achieve. That might be another criticism that's added to that list. And in the case of Mali, you can see we're working mainly with youth, with what we call vulnerable communities, and of course women. And we got beaten up at the board because someone said, why are you only working with 27% of women when half of the world are women? And we pointed out that half of the youth are also girls. And so there are women in there. I've failed my geography test. Forgive me, Jason and Ben. And let me use Nigeria to make one other observation. And again, you can see the maps and numbers here. I'll use this slide to demonstrate and discuss this very quickly. We are funding thousands of initiatives in hundreds of local communities, and the pleasure of these is that they're all different, and they're really sometimes quite unusual. But if I was forced to categorise them, and these are rough categories, and we still have to work through what we're doing, we've only just started doing it, I think there are three broad categories of initiatives that we are funding. One is around raising awareness of violent extremism. And here you can see some examples. We're using theatre and arts and culture. We're providing training, we're providing research, radio programming, training for journalists, research and analysis again. Trying to make sure that people understand the warning signs, whether it's clerics in mosques, whether it's teachers in schools, whether it's mothers in communities, understand, and there are clear warning signs, what the warning signs might be that somebody in your community is being tempted or taking the wrong direction. And we can go into that a bit further. The second broad set of activities is around mobilising against violent extremism. For example, promoting community dialogue. For example, working with youth action teams, peace rallies, community response teams, sports events, and so on and so forth. And there are literally hundreds of examples of initiatives that fall broadly within that definition. The third and increasingly obviously to me the most important is about providing concrete alternatives. Now, it is almost impossible to generalize. One of the challenges of preventing violent extremism is that it is so locally specific. It's almost impossible, you know, you think it's religion, I can find you people who are doing this who are not religious. You think it's poverty, I can point to middle-class students in Bangladesh who are committing terrorist attacks, and so on and so forth. Something around disenfranchisement, something around marginalization, I think there's some key concepts. But the main thing that we have found in our research is that people are tempted to turn to extremism when they find they have no other alternative. If you can get kids back into school, if you can provide training to people, if you can provide loans to people, if you can provide job opportunities, entrepreneurship training to people, then mostly they make the right decision and not the wrong decision. Of course, some will clearly make the wrong decision, but we found that providing concrete alternatives really makes a significant difference when we're trying to prevent violent extremism. The final point I'd make about these activities, and this is why I think GCERF is exciting but also immensely difficult. These have been identified by the communities, not by us. We're not saying there's been some great research at Chatham House or Lowy or Brookings or the Graduate Institute, the various other places I am affiliated with. We are saying you are the community, ladies and gentlemen. You tell us what the problem is. You tell us what the solutions are and we will give you the money. It's quite an unusual model. And when you first have this discussion, communities are, what are you talking about? And you just reiterate, if you can tell us what you think the solutions are, we can provide the small grants to help you launch these. Now, you know, in parentheses, risk, failure, all of that is there, and we'll come back to that in a moment. So those are three slides showing the sorts of work that we're doing in these three countries at the moment, Bangladesh, Mali, Nigeria. Again, expanding this year into Kenya, Kosovo and Myanmar, and I suspect another three countries probably next year as well. We're a global fund. We have to continue to try to expand. OK, a couple of final slides. Firstly, I think we've spent the last 2 years at GCERF proving that concept. And you remember the concept. The concept was that you need to focus at the local level to make a difference. The concept was that there's a funding gap, and the concept was that a multi-sectoral global fund like GCERF is the best way, the most effective way to fill that funding gap. And here's just a few bullet points that I think have demonstrated that GCERF has at least begun to prove the concept. And I think we still have to do more, but I think we're beginning to prove the concept. Firstly, community focus. We've commissioned baseline studies in all of the communities where we're working. You understand the principle. You do a baseline study, you intervene for 3 years, and then you go back and hopefully there's been a change, hopefully it's been positive, and hopefully you can demonstrate that you can take some plausible, credit for what's changed. Now, of course, you know, even the mighty USAID, who puts a lot of money into this stuff, even USAID accepts that you can do no more than plausible correlation. There was a problem, we put in money, something's changed. Hopefully we were part of why something's changed, but it could be that something completely different took place to make it change. I mean, demonstrating correlation is immensely difficult in this field, but anyway, we've commissioned baseline studies amongst all of the communities. I think those baseline studies demonstrate very clearly that in many cases, the causes, the consequences, and the solutions for violent extremism are at the local level. To give you a few examples, causes. I mean, when you look at some of the research that we've commissioned in terms of baseline studies, the big causes that come out are around poverty and unemployment. I looked at just one this morning, one of the baselines in Nigeria. 22% of people who responded to the baseline study said, we think the main reason people are turning to violent extremism is unemployment. 12% said poverty. 3% said the security forces. 2% said government corruption. Now, these are, you know, this isn't scientific classification, but I would argue that unemployment and poverty are locally based, whereas corruption, security forces are clearly nationally based. There's clearly a set of issues and a set of challenges at the local level that seem to matter to people. Consequences, it's physical injury. And even in the Central Belt, and we got beaten up by the board a couple of years ago about this, why are you working in the Central Belt, not Northern Nigeria? The baseline studies in the Central Belt show that 93% of people we interviewed are worried about violent extremism. 45% have directly experienced violent extremism. There's been a loss of property, a loss of livelihood, there's been displacement, there's been death, and this is in the Central Belt, let alone what's happening in the Northern Belt. So our baseline studies demonstrate that there are indeed challenges even in the Central Belt, and again, the consequences are localised to people living in those communities, as are the solutions. When you ask people what the solutions are, it's about employment, it's about training, it's about peace education, much more than police reform, corruption, and national governance. Now, I'm not discounting the national level or the international level, but I think that we have demonstrated the local level does matter, and it's been missed out over the last few years, and we really need to focus, in addition to national and international concerns, we need to focus at the local level. The funding gap, well, this is where, this is a presentation I would find difficult to make to my donors, but I'll make it to you since you're my friends. Our research demonstrates that there is a funding gap. The sub-recipients, the very small community-based organisations that we're trying to reach, you remember that series of arrows across the slides. Firstly, none of them has ever received international funds before. This is the first time they've ever received international funding. Secondly, absolutely, none of them, A, have ever received money on preventing violent extremism, or B, frankly, know what it is. You know, one of the real challenges is going to local communities and saying, we want you to write a proposal, we want to work with you on preventing violent extremism. And they said, you know, it's food security or climate change or the Fulani herdsmen or gender inequality or what do you mean by preventing violent extremism? So these are local organisations. Don't be surprised they don't know the vernacular, the terminology. The most, I mean, concerning is that they clearly, by definition, have a weak capacity. We do the FIDA, the fiduciary assessments of all of these SRs. Most of them fail. They have no experience of managing funds, they have no staff, they have no budget experience, they have no accountants, they have nothing, they have no audit trail, they have nothing whatsoever. This is the price you pay, ladies and gentlemen, for trying to reach the local level. This is why development has found it so difficult to reach the local level. This is why most development money goes to NGOs, which are great. Mercy Corps, Save the Children, they do great work, but they are reliable, safe recipients. GCERF is about trying to reach the next level down. So, you know, there's a, again, real degree of risk and failure around the sorts of people that we're trying to reach. But I think, again, our research demonstrates pretty clearly that there is a funding gap that needs to be filled. Now, the final piece of this is about using a multisectoral global fund, and I'll finish this with two slides. Let me just go back to what I said at the beginning. These are the potential strengths that have been identified of multisectoral global funds, and let me reflect on how GCERF is trying to leverage those strengths to achieve what we are trying to achieve. The first, remember, was providing a political focal point on difficult issues. I think we're trying to do that in two ways. First, at the international level, I think by providing political neutrality, Swiss-based, multi-stakeholder, multiple donors, remember that spreading risk notion, I think we are providing a safe space for donors that might find it difficult to work in this space to come together. Some of our donors, 14 donors, some of them already are working on preventing violent extremism in the US, the UK. Some of them have got no experience whatsoever in this, but this is an opportunity for them to become involved in a safe space. So political neutrality is bringing new donors and providing a political focal point around preventing violent extremism. The second point there, security development, even within single states like the US, like the UK, like France, we are bringing together for the first time security actors and development actors. GCERF, by definition, sits somewhere on a security development nexus or spectrum. I often describe GCERF as using development inputs, women's empowerment, training, entrepreneurship, to achieve security outcomes, trying to make communities more resilient against the risk of violent extremism. And one of the great challenges of GCERF is that half of our money comes from development actors and half of it comes from security actors. And these people don't talk to each other, they don't agree with each other, they're suspicious of each other, and they have very different expectations of us as a global fund. So within a single country like Australia or the UK, you have two board members who have completely different outlooks on what GCERF should be and what it's trying to achieve and how you can demonstrate results. It's a real challenge. But again, providing that political focal point, I think, is an important contribution that GCERF has made. Resource mobilisation, well, as I said, in 2.5 years, and I am modest but proud, we've got 14 donors. We've attracted around $40 million. We've got strong private sector engagement thanks to the hard work of Amy, who is responsible for our private sector engagement. We're in New York next Wednesday hosting a big foundations event with high net worth individuals and philanthropists and foundations. It's not easy, but we're beginning to warm that group up as well. And I think we're also demonstrating the innovation which is expected of multisectoral global funds. We're about to launch in Kenya a public-private partnership, which is where GCERF puts $1 on the table, a private company puts $1 on the table, and we put $2 into a local community. So it's a way of kind of incentivizing and leveraging private sector interests. And we'll use social impact bonds going forward and so on and so forth. So some innovation around resource mobilization, I think, is there. Expanding reach in two ways. One is depth. And I mentioned the challenges of access. We already can demonstrate that we are reaching communities that are out of reach of most bilateral donors, in particular because of that question of access and trust and confidence. And let's be honest, I think to an extent GCERF is being used by some donors to access communities that they couldn't do alone, but they really want to access. And, you know, we just have to accept that as part of our instrumentalization by some of these states. But clearly we are already reaching communities in places that are absolutely politically out of reach of the US, France, the UK, Australia, and so on and so forth, because of the various reasons we've discussed, politics, colonialism, so on and so forth. That's the depth piece. The breadth piece, if by the end of this year, as we intend, we are providing considerable funds in 6 countries, we already will be working in more countries on preventing violent extremism than any single bilateral donor other than the USA. I mean, the UK focuses on Kenya and Tunisia. The US does quite a lot of work around various other countries. Australia focuses on Indonesia. There is some work taking place, but very few countries go beyond their specific national interest, which, of course, is understandable. GCERF is a way to expand the reach, to expand the expertise, to do the comparison, to generate the data. Already, we are beginning to demonstrate that we have the reach that goes far beyond what any single donor has or, frankly, has an interest in doing. So I think we're beginning to demonstrate the expanding reach. Spreading risk, look, there are 3 risks around what GCERF is doing, and I hope that we succeed. The concept is a risk. preventing violent extremism is a difficult concept. It was largely driven by the State Department. It was largely driven by President Obama and Hillary Clinton and then John Kerry. Who knows what Mr. Trump is going to do? Who knows what the future of the PVE, preventing violent extremism, agenda is? This is not an easy agenda to move around or to work in, and lots of people are still very sceptical of it, and I don't blame them. There's risk around the concept. There's clearly risk, as I've indicated, around trying to reach grassroots organisations. Most of them are failing the feeder. Most of them do not have the fiduciary assessment outcomes that are required of the sorts of organisations that most donors would give money to. And clearly, there are risks around results. And I always say there are three challenges about demonstrating results and preventing violent extremism. One is that prevention is, by definition, long-term. The other is that, by definition, you're trying to prove the counterfactual. We can show that we've empowered 100 women. Can we show that we've stopped one of them becoming a terrorist? That's a much more difficult ask. And the other thing is, this is about behavioural change. It takes years to affect individual and community behaviour, not days. So for all sorts of reasons, there are risks around results. And to the credit of our donors, they understand and get the risk. They have a very clear red line. If any of our money ends up in the hands of terrorists or violent extremists, it's over. Now, if some of your projects fail, that's fine. If a group of women in Mali need $5,000 to launch something that doesn't work out, we accept. You know, we'd rather keep the failure down, but we accept that's going to happen. So managing the risk is, I think, clearly very important, understandably, to the donors. Economies of scale and expertise. Well, let's be clear. The reason that the EU gives us $5 million is that we slice that $5 million up into small grants, which, frankly, the EU simply can't do. The notion of the EU giving out a $10,000 grant is impossible. By the time their lawyers and bureaucrats have gone through it, the money will have disappeared. So they basically are outsourcing the pain of managing small grants to us. The point being, if you give us lots of money and we have a secretariat, then we can do it fairly easily. So you're developing economies of scale, especially around small grant giving, by giving us large amounts of money and letting us generate the expertise to issue and monitor and evaluate those small grants. And I mentioned M&E there as well. The real expertise that everyone is looking to GCERF to demonstrate and to develop is on monitoring and evaluation. How on earth do you monitor and evaluate and demonstrate results and demonstrate impact around preventing violent extremism at the local level? That's kind of the big conundrum. To an extent, GCERF is a laboratory. We've been asked to do lots of difficult things, to engage the private sector in a politically sensitive issue, to demonstrate results around something that's very hard to demonstrate results, to reach the grassroots, which by definition are risky and difficult. And we've been set up to try to do all of that as a sort of laboratory. And I often think of GCERF as a kind of lab, and it's quite fun to work in a lab. My final slide. How are we, again, early, modest, but how are we trying to address the existing and obvious weaknesses of multisectoral global funds? First, again, remember the point about policymaking in isolation. You are addressing one part of a bigger picture. Whenever I do media interviews, which I do increasingly, which I think, you know, the modern person has to have media skills because it's part of what we're all going to do in the future. So start training on media skills, Ben, at the geography department. Whenever I do media interviews, what I say is GCERF is not the solution, but there can be no solution without GCERF. We are an absolutely fundamental part of a broader solution. And I think that's a strong line that I have. The way that we try to overcome the challenge of policymaking in isolation, especially around governments and national governments, is that we try to promote national ownership. My point being here that we can do all sorts of work at the local level, train women, get kids back into school, but if the police are corrupt, if the system is against you name the ethnic group, then it's pretty hard to really make a difference. That's why we work through governments. That's why we set up our country support mechanisms. That's why we try to make sure that governments are with us and on board with us, and that GCERF is part of their national approach and national strategy to doing this. It's difficult. I'm not sure we're achieving it yet. But the point of trying to develop national ownership, I think, is to make sure that the states are addressing all of the other things that need to be addressed to make sure that we can really succeed. The other point is political accountability. And let's be very honest about this. Twice a year, senior members, the Foreign Secretary of Bangladesh, senior people from the countries receiving money come to a board meeting, I've described it, the 15 people around the table, the constituencies around the room, and are held to account. If Bangladesh starts to misspend money or starts to be accused of corruption, someone senior will have to come to a public board meeting. All of our board minutes are transparent, they're on the website, and explain why. And I think that governance structure is one of many ways that we try to hold governments to account. So we are trying to leverage and impact the other pieces that need to be put in place to try to make sure that GCERF succeeds. Less democratically accountable, true. The only way we can resolve this is to hold the line. Already I can see, and we just had our fifth board meeting, our sixes in London in June, already I can see the donors trying to dominate the board meetings. It's quite clear, you know, this is fine, this kind of fancy constituency, but we're the donors, it's our money, we want decision-making powers. We want the others out of the room, and we want to make decisions. Now, our chair, Carol Bellamy, the former head of UNICEF, former president of New York City Council, a really tough woman, is absolutely crystal clear. There will be no separate decision-making, there will be no separate meetings of any decision-making authority by the donors. You have signed up to a multi-stakeholder constituency board where civil society has the same voice as the USA. If you don't like it, you can leave. Take your money and go. And the only way we can do this is to hold the line and resist the temptation by donors to try to dominate it. We'll see how far we go, but we're alert to the issue and we're just trying to hold the line at the moment. It'll change. Duplication, well, the answer here is to partner up. Let's make sure that the work we are doing complements what Mercy Corps is doing in Nigeria or what the UN is trying to do in many other countries and so on and so forth. The only way to make sure that you avoid duplication is to partner. And in some countries, GCERF can even take a coordinating role and make sure that we are the people who are helping to coordinate the various efforts. I've got two colleagues in Nairobi this week, and they are going around all of the PVE donors, finding out what they're doing to make sure that we are doing something additional, to make sure we are doing something that fills the gap and doesn't simply duplicate what's already taking place. And Kenya is particularly crowded at the moment. Substitutive, not additive. Now, this might be slightly technical, but it's on my mind all the time. So you have earmarked and unearmarked funding. Earmarked funding is the UK gives, and this is an example, it's just a kind of notional example. Earmarked funding is the UK gives us £5 million and says we want to focus this money on women in Kenya. That is substitutive. That's us doing the UK's work for them. Unearmarked money is the UK gives us £5 million and says this is going into the pot of $40 million and you will use your expertise to spend this as is appropriate to prevent violent extremism around the world. The only way to make sure that we are additive, not substitutive, is to guard against earmarked funding. There's no point. If you want to go and work on women in Kenya, go and do it. You don't need me. You don't need GCERF. Just go and do it. If you want to try to have a global reach, if you want to try to access local communities, if you want to generate expertise, if you want to realise the potential of a multi-sectoral global fund, then give me unearmarked money. And this is a constant battle because, of course, most donors have a clear national interest. The Brits are interested in Tunisia because there was the terrible attack in Suez and so on and so forth. So on an issue like violent extremism, persuading states to go beyond their national interest, persuading France to go beyond West Africa and the Sahel is a particularly difficult thing to do, but we've just got to, again, hold the line and try to make sure that we do it. My final point, diversion of responsibilities. Well, I've spoken about partnership and I've spoken about promoting national ownership. Dependency, and again, I think this is difficult, but this is the GCERF model. The GCERF model is we provide local communities funding for 3 years and part of the funding is capacity building. So that when our money leaves in 3 years, which it will, you know how to fill in a log frame. You've got the contacts with the local small grants office of the Swiss embassy. You've got someone who's got a bit of an audit experience because we've given you training on audit. You, in other words, can fill the funding gap yourself. And I think that's really important that we provide a short-term plug for the funding gap and the capacity to make sure that people can do it for themselves in the long term. I'll finish there, but I'd just like to acknowledge, I acknowledged Amy, Richard Barrett, who came in a couple of minutes late. Richard was a founding father of GCERF. He was on the first board. I think he's also served on the IRP. Richard, thanks for all of your support, and it's great to have you here. The money's the real question. And, you know, we're under real pressure, again, not unreasonably, but I think slightly unreasonably, from our donors in particular. They insist that we keep our operating expenses to 15% or less. Now, that's a fantasy, frankly, especially in the startup phase. You know, we just spent 2 years building an institution, hiring people. Of course, it's going to cost money. Now the fixed costs are in places you can begin to... You understand the kind of the line. So we have a real struggle. We've got to support a secretariat, firstly, that travels a lot, that lives in Geneva, which is not the cheapest place to live. We've got to transfer money to principal recipients, who are the local NGOs that are registered to actually receive this money because they've got bank accounts and audits and so on and so forth. They need some money for capacity, and then the money goes from them down to sub-recipients. So there's always money being lost through that chain. And we just have a really strong argument to the board that you shouldn't count, for example, the money goes to principal recipients as overheads, because it's not overheads. Because what those principal recipients are doing is providing the training and the capacity for the SRs to make sure that this is sustainable. So you can play with the figures, But I would argue that something like 25% of money is taken up by secretariat and PR costs, and I think most of the rest goes to SRs, which is pretty miraculous, frankly, and we'll see if we can maintain that. So a lot of energy and a lot of hard work, and we've got to make it better. I mean, the big funds, Gavi, the Vaccine Alliance, I think its overhead is 2% because it has 6 billion and it has a relatively small secretariat and most of its money goes straight out. So the nature of the work we're doing, trying to reach local communities, is by definition expensive with lots of financial hurdles going through. One of the challenges of a multi-sectoral global fund, we have the key thing we do is feed everyone who receives money from us, including secretariat staff, through anti-terrorism lists. Because again, the nightmare is money goes to terrorists. But each of our 14 donors has a different anti-terrorism list, right? So you know, there are some people listed by the US that aren't listed by the Swiss. So keeping 14 donors happy with different reporting requirements, with different screening lists, with all sorts of different apparatuses is an immensely difficult thing to do. But yes, I mean, we screen every single individual. Indeed, for the PRs, we screen every board member. We screen everybody who's in any way associated with this organisation to try to make sure that they are not, well, to absolutely ensure that they're not on the existing anti-terrorist lists. And yes, then the PRs then go and work with the SRs to do the sorts of screening that you're speaking about. Again, this all costs. I'm not quite sure I get the question, but I think I understand the nature of it. And by the way, on the refugee stuff, which again, I do lots of work, understandably, I tried to leave refugees behind, but it then became a big... As soon as I leave an issue, when I retire from GCERF, violent extremism will spike, I warn you. So if you're looking to kind of anti-investment, kind of correlate yourself against me. But that's one of the reasons the private sector is so involved. I've got very good friends at Western Union and Jabani, and they're the ones who are doing this in a much more direct manner. You know, when the refugees are arriving in Jordan and Turkey and Lebanon and Greece, for that matter, they're not asking for tents or blankets. The first question, where can I plug my mobile phone in? This is the new world that, you know, I need to phone my mum to tell her I got here safely. So I think the private sector is really filling that kind of innovation gap around some of the refugee responses. And again, Amy's working on that for us. But yes, again, we are providing the old-fashioned training. You know, again, it's about sustainability. We hope that in 3 years when we go, and we will go, we don't want to create dependency, you've got the capacity to raise some money yourself. Because the money is there, you know, the local USAID office in, and Ben knows these places, in Nigeria or Kenya, they do have small grants programs. The Swiss have small grants programs. The thing is, you don't know about them, you haven't got the network, you can't afford to go to the capital, you don't know how to fill in the form. So if we can give you the networks, we had a meeting today at the House of Lords with a potential funder for some of our recipients. You know, if in 3 years' time we can build their capacity, they can then apply for this fund and we can sort of pass it on somehow. So that's what we're trying to, and again, we're only filling the funding gap. We're an issue-based organisation. But I understand the challenges. I understand that people are sick of capacity building, but we have to insist upon it. I mean, look, security is part of it. Again, I mean, just to give you an insight, one of the most tense moments in these big board meetings, and my life has become obsessed with, they're kind of, I don't know what the equivalent is, exam board meetings or something at universities, but my life revolves around the board meetings. And I think the tensest moment we had was the big row with the US, who said, you have no credibility if you're not working in northern Nigeria. No, just no credibility. And we explained that we haven't decided to work in the Central Belt. We have a local committee made up of government, private sector and donors. They have advised us to work in the Central Belt. We have an independent review panel made up of experts like Richard. They have confirmed that the Central Belt is a coming challenge. The board voted to work there. That's why we haven't just made this up. So there's kind of a governance piece that puts us in there. But of course, security is also an issue. And there's no doubt at all it would be quite hard for us to go and do monitoring and evaluation in Syria or Yemen at the moment. So the prevention piece means we're working in places that perhaps aren't as unsafe as they would be if we're working on kind of reactive rather than proactive. But yes, it will come. You know, we're working in, again, this is a 3-year commitment, so I'm sure some of the places we're working in now may become inaccessible. And I think we've just got to work out how to deal with it. On the startup piece, you know, I went through those kind of the reason I took this job, the challenges, the kind of new intellectual challenge, the startup and the institution. What I've learned about a startup is you completely underestimate, we all completely underestimate the infrastructure that exists behind a job. The human resources, the annual evaluations, the heating, the rent, the cleaning, the insurance, the kidnapping, and all of the stuff that you take for granted as an employee. And we've set that up from absolute scratch. Salary levels. You know, we've got 20 staff of different grades. What grades, what salaries, what promotions. I mean, all of this stuff we just had to make up. So there's been an enormous amount of learning, and we'll have to learn around this as well. And I'm sure some of this stuff will go wrong, and I'm sure some of it will be inaccessible, and we're just going to have to kind of feel our way through it. But thankfully, the donors at the moment have given us that leeway. They recognise that this is a challenge, which makes it kind of interesting. There are a couple of other questions. On the resilience, what does resilience look like? It's a great question. And again, we're doing baseline studies. We'll intervene for 3 years, and then we'll come back and hopefully show that there's been some changes. Hopefully, we can take some credit for some of those changes. But the point, I think, is that when people within a community begin to take the wrong track, become foreign fighters and want to go to Syria, or when outsiders, Boko Haram, comes knocking, then there's some scope for resistance. There's a community-level organisation where mothers or clerics can come together and say, something's going wrong, let's resist. There's critical thinking, so that children can say, he's saying that, but actually the Quran doesn't say that, and my father taught me something else. There's abilities to reach out to local governments and police forces to try to build those networks. I mean, there's all sorts of ways you can define resilience and what resilience means and looks like. But for me, it's ultimately about trying to make sure there are options other than turning kind of vaguely blindly to violent extremist agendas. And you can, you know, the middle-class Bangladeshi students who shot up that cafe, the Holy Cafe, last year in Dhaka, you know, these people, it's very easy. I mean, I used to work a lot on migrant smuggling and human trafficking. And it's a similar sort of pitch. You're a young Bangladeshi guy, you're a virgin, you're finding it hard to find friends, you can't really pay the fees. Come with me this evening. There's a great chess club. There's some nice girls there. I can give you a few dollars if you need to pay the fees. And suddenly you're part of a community and you feel part. And then the next, I mean, these people aren't fools. It's quite a charming, it's what we think of as an irrational decision often is quite rational for some people. It's about money. You know, Richard knows his mum. We must invite Richard to speak. But, you know, there are places in Pakistan where you will pay a boy $20 to go and strap a belt around himself and blow himself up, and he'll take it because it's $20. I mean, there's some really strange economics of this that I think needs much more research. So I think defining resilience is difficult, and we need to, again, work through it. The other question, I just wrote down 3 years, but how long we are in. At the moment, it's 3 years per project. Now, we might stay in countries for longer, we might stay in communities for longer, but we have a three-year commitment to particular projects at the moment. Yes, we're a non-profit, we're a Swiss foundation, no profit whatsoever, and I think that's important. It's part of the independence and impartiality and kind of credibility of what we're doing. I'll invite Amy to come up in a minute. I think the world is moving into kind of MGF Mark II. MGF Mark I was AIDS, and someone asked about the climate change fund. And I don't want to speak, you know, there's only about 20 of us in the world who run these funds, so I don't want to speak ill of colleagues. I don't know what the answer is, but I do know that most funds have found it difficult to give money out early. And you can understand why. They've got to get project proposals in, they've got to screen, they've got to do the accountability. It's just, the process of giving out grants is not as easy as one might imagine. And especially around climate change, I can imagine it's quite hard to, you know, what's a concrete project that's combating climate change? I can imagine the sorts of challenges. I can imagine the politics at his board. I think it's a guy at his board where you've got skeptics and academics. I mean, I don't know the answer, but I know that we've got money out in record. I think compared to any other global fund, we got money out quickly. And I'm very proud of that. Because, you know, just as an aside, looking back at my migration career, my fear about migration is it's fallen into talk shop dialogue summitry. And if we do the same with PVE, we're doomed. We've got to make sure this is action-oriented, not just dialogue-oriented. And I think I'm pleased that GCERF is at least somehow action-oriented. But that was just an aside. MGF's Mark II, in the old days, there was a political momentum around an issue and massive amounts of money followed. That's what happened with AIDS. That's what happened with the vaccines. I think that's what might happen with the abortion fund, because there's this anti-Trump piece that will go around that. I think we are an example of a new fund where there's political momentum, but it isn't followed by large amounts of money. So we're being made to work much harder than the previous funds have. And this is one of the challenges I have, and I'm not going to name names, but I've got two colleagues working in our team who are used to the old funds, and they're just immensely frustrated. It's like, well, why aren't they writing us a cheque for $500 million? Because that's what they are supposed to do. And it's kind of, you don't... In the old days, yes, but not, you know, now you've got to beg for every dollar. You've got to convince, you've got to demonstrate results. The old days are gone. So I think multisectoral global funds do work. Whether it's the appropriate mechanism for what we're trying to do, I don't know. The Global Fund and Gavi basically support national health systems. That's quite easy. You can give $1 billion to Botswana's national health system and make sure it spends its money relatively accountably. Trying to give out small grants to the local level via an MGF is something quite new and quite different. I think the Climate Fund is trying to do something quite similar. So, you know, what I always say about GCERF is that we we were given the architecture of a mega fund. Our architecture is basically the same as a global fund's. Board, CSM, independent review panel, but they've got $16 billion and we've got $50 million, right? So something's got to give. Either you've got to grow this or you've got to shrink this. And I think, for me, the real challenge about GCERF is we've got to adapt our governance to satisfy the means. So, you know, MGF Mark II is that development funds are being cut. There's real retrenchment. We're focusing on national interests and trying to convince governments to invest in public goods, global public goods, I think is increasingly difficult. So there is potential, but let's be, the old days are gone, I think.